Somerset Berkley Regional School Committee to order at 6:35 p.m. due notice having been posted. Let the record show that this meeting is being electronically recorded. And if anyone in the audience also wishes to electronically record this meeting, you should notify the committee at this time. Any such recording may be subject to reasonable restrictions imposed by the chair to the extent permitted under the open meeting law. Roll call. Mrs. Gagliardi?
Here.
Mr. Giliducci?
Here.
Mrs. Terra?
Here.
Kara Knuse?
Here.
And the chair is present. Unfortunately, Mr. Larrabee has a business engagement this evening. Mrs. Field is not feeling well, and Mr. Machado is traveling. But we do have a quorum. Also present is the Superintendent of Schools, Jeffrey Schoonover, our Director of Business and Finance, Lindsay Albernaz, our Director of Curriculum, Elizabeth Haskell, and our Recording Secretary, Robin Vaccaro. I would ask everyone to stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And I'm sorry, I didn't mention that we also have our Director of Special Education, Lisa Montesian, with us this evening as well. So we will begin. We're very pleased to have with us this evening Colby Yokel, a senior at Somerset Berkley Regional High School, who was selected to attend the National Journalism Conference this past summer in Washington, D.C., and her mentor, so to speak, a member of the English department and the person who recommended her for the conference, one of our faculty members in the English department, Benjamin Chase. So welcome to both of you. I'll turn the floor over to you.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
Yes, thank you so much. Good evening. My name is Colby Yokel, and I'm a senior this year at Somerset Berkley Regional High School. I'm also the editor of the school newspaper, The Breeze. And a correspondent for the local newspaper, The Spectator. In July, I was nominated to attend a national journalism conference in Washington, D.C. The Washington Journalism and Media Conference, also known as WJMC, is held at George Mason University in Fairfax, Virginia, which is located roughly 30 minutes outside of Washington, D.C. WJMC brings together students from all over the country for an in-depth study of journalism and the media. WJMC provides a dynamic leadership experience and allows students to exhibit the inherent major innovations in and the major issues with the media. During the week that I was at the Washington Journalism and Media Conference, I was able to visit the museum, the monuments in the White House, the National Press Club, the Holocaust Museum, heard from leading speakers and journalists in the field, partook in a news media simulation, discussed media bias and censorship, and had the opportunity to meet with our representatives on Capitol Hill. The second day we were there, we visited the museum, which is a museum in Washington, D.C., dedicated to the championing the freedoms of the First Amendment, more specifically, the freedom of press and the freedom of speech. In the museum, we were able to see the role that the media played in the reaction to 9/11, and also an exhibit that examined the inherent issues with the media, such as who controls the news, can we really trust the media, and the rampant sensationalism present in the news. We also heard from leading journalists in the field. In all, we heard from 16 journalists. One of my favorite speakers was Brian Lamb, who is the founder of C-SPAN. Brian Lamb's speech was very different from all of the other speeches we heard, in that he actually didn't do a lot of speaking. He actually let most of the students do a lot of the talking. He asked us to tell interesting stories about our lives. In fact, I was kind of aggravated with his decision to do this at first because I had paid a sizable tuition, part of which was dedicated to listening to him speak. However, one girl told of her grandparents fleeing Poland during the Holocaust because they were Jewish. One correspondent told of his relatives fleeing India during the India-Pakistan split because they were being persecuted. Another told of her relatives being forced to work as sharecroppers during the Great Depression. I soon realized that what Lamb was doing, getting everyone to tell their stories, was exactly what journalism is all about. The best thing that you can do when you're young is listen to other people's stories, Lamb said. I realized just how profound and significant Lamb's message was, though he did not directly spell it out for us. It is our job as journalists to tell the stories of those who deserve to be heard, and to ask the right questions, and be willing and eager to listen. Since hearing his speech, I have been able to open my eyes to my own family's history and the stories of those around me. As it turns out, by listening and absorbing, you can learn a lot more than by simply waiting for your turn to speak. One of my other favorite speakers was April Ryan, who is a political analyst for CNN and part of the White House press corps. Actually, just before she had to speak to us, she got a notification that there was an emergency press briefing at the White House, so she actually had to run all the way to the White House and then back to the National Press Club to speak to us. So the reason why I liked April Ryan so much was because she told it how it really was. She didn't add in any of the unicorns or butterflies that so many of the other speakers had. She gave all of us a reality check. She even said that she does not even know if there will be such a thing as a White House correspondent in a few years. She talked about how the news has changed, what it takes to be a journalist, and how the press has come under attack by the current presidential administration. She talked about how the news has changed, specifically citing that technology has been brought to the forefront of reporting, which has put a lot of journalists out of work. It helps and it's a hindrance, Ryan said. She also talked about what it takes to be a journalist. To be a journalist, we have to be tenacious and realize that the field is not all about putting forth our own ideas and beliefs, but rather covering all sides of the story for the benefit of the masses. She emphasized that journalism is not a pretty game and that we will undoubtedly get our feelings hurt. If you're faint of heart and you don't know who you are, don't come to Washington to be a journalist, Ryan said. She also talked about how the press has come under attack. She said that as journalists, we need to continue to do our job and to do it fairly, despite the difficulties that the press are now facing. However, my favorite speaker throughout the week was Kevin McCarthy, who is a movie critic for a local TV news station. It's kind of weird that Kevin McCarthy was my favorite speaker because I don't often write movie reviews, and though I do enjoy watching them and discussing them. However, he was my favorite speaker because I was able to empathize with him. His hopes and dreams were similar to my own, and so was his dedication and drive, which made his accomplishment of his goals even more inspirational. A George Mason alumni, his story made my doubts and fears, but also my hopes and dreams be realized. He represented a different niche of journalism than what we had previously seen at the National Journalism Conference. He is so down-to-earth and entertaining, and his stories about his interviews with famous celebrities were shocking and hilarious. McCarthy basically had to pave his own way into journalism. He had to work for free for 8 years. He was forced to work as a sales representative on the side for 8 years because he was only making $28,000 per year. He had to borrow money from everyone he knew. However, he persevered and he now works his dream job. Do what you love and the money will follow, McCarthy said. Hearing about his struggles to pursue his dream job was so relatable to me because that has always been a reason as to why my career decision has always been torn. I have always been faced with, should I do what makes the most money or should I do what makes me happy? Hearing his decision to stick with his passion and to not give up on his dreams was so inspiring for me. He also talked about his interviews with famous celebrities. In fact, for example, once he was walking down the beach with Dwayne The Rock Johnson, another time he had to interview the entire cast of The Force Awakens without actually seeing the movie, because J.J. Abrams would not let anyone view it beforehand. Also, he told us that in interviews, ask questions that genuinely interest us and to always stay passionate. When we work as interns, ask questions and make sure everyone in the workplace knows our names. Stick to your gun. Stick to what your passions are and people will latch on, McCarthy said. Being part of the conference, I got special access to the National Press Club. Today, the National Press Club is the world's leading organization for journalists. It was so inspiring and humbling to be able to sit where professional journalists, world leaders, and politicians once stood. It also made me question if I would ever be able to go back there one day as a professional journalist. We were also split into color groups, in which we were talking about media bias and censorship. In one activity, we were split into three separate groups, in which every group was assigned to read a different article by a different publication with a different political lean. In this group, all of the articles were about the same thing, which was President Trump's decision to withdraw from the Paris Climate Accords. When we were reading the articles, we had to decide what bias it was and what made it bias. So my group's article was a conservative-leaning article. However, my entire group thought it was a liberal-leaning article. So it turns out that the staff of the conference actually had the same problem. And we later realized that all of us that were reading that article in the group were liberal-minded individuals as well. It was so eye-opening to me because it made me realize that we had read the article how we wanted to read the article, and it made me examine my own internal biases and how it affects the way I interpret things. We also got to take part in a news media simulation in which every individual was assigned to a different media outlet. Unfortunately, I was assigned to BuzzFeed. And we were presented with 5 fictional breaking news stories, and based on these leads that we got, we had to pick which story would be published as this top story, and we also had to write an article that was in the media outlet's bias. It was probably one of the most interesting things that I've ever done in my entire life. Well, to say the least, WJMC was a week that will live within me forever. I learned so much, not only about journalism, but also about the people all around me. Even though I had never left the East Coast, I felt like I learned so much about the culture in different parts of the United States. It also helped me decide what I want to do for the rest of my life. And it also helped me see what college is like, kind of, which is helpful because I will be attending college in the fall. Because I was the only correspondent from Somerset Berkley Regional High School and one of 6 from Massachusetts, I was forced out of my comfort zone, but I would not have wanted it any other way. Feeling a little bit uncomfortable allowed me to create new and powerful friendships and memories that will last a lifetime. I believe that I was able to truly enjoy every moment of this conference to its fullest. WJMC made me realize the importance of journalism, now more than ever. It has strengthened and deepened my love for journalism and has made me realize that I cannot imagine myself in a career where I am not obligated to write. That being said, it has strengthened my decision to major in English in college. Recently, I have been accepted to several colleges, one of them being George Mason University, where the conference took place. I am so grateful for the opportunities that WJMC has provided me. It has allowed me to grow so much, not only as a journalist, but also as a person, opening my eyes to things that aren't taught in the classroom. It has given me life experiences and friendships that I will cherish forever. In fact, I still talk to some of my best friends from the conference every single day. As a WJMC alumni, I have the ability to nominate different students from SBRHS year after year to attend this conference and experience this same life-changing opportunity. It has truly changed my worldview. It has made me realize simply that the world is so much bigger than Somerset Berkley Regional High School. It is so much bigger than Massachusetts. There are so many wonderful, beautiful people out there. There are so many endless opportunities. I feel that the future is bright, and I cannot wait to see what it holds. I'd like to thank the school committee for inviting Mr. Chase and myself here to speak tonight, as well as you guys for allowing me to speak to you about something that is so special to me. I'd also like to thank Ms. Copeland as an advisor for The Breeze, who's helped me along my path. And I'd also like to thank Mr. Chase, who has literally changed my life. Without him, I'm not even sure I would have joined The Breeze in the first place. I probably never would have developed my passion for journalism. And without him and his nomination for this conference, I definitely would never have had the opportunity to attend. So thank you, Mr. Chase, 1,000 times over.
You're so ready.
Yeah, so this is a little video that actually my best friend at the conference made.
When you take that jump, don't fear the fall. Hope when the water rises, you build a wall. Hope when the crowd screams out, screaming your name. Hope if everybody runs, you choose to stay. Hope that you fall in love and it hurts so bad. Oh.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Colby, and it's quite obvious why Mr. Chase thought this would be a great program for you. You've given us a great presentation. It's obvious that you really enjoyed the program and gained a tremendous amount from it, and congratulations, and much success next year in college and pursuing your career in journalism. And I would also like to commend Mr. Chase for his initiative in pointing out this program to you, and he obviously was able to see that this was an opportunity for you, and as a teacher and a mentor, he kind of guided you in that direction and kind of set a career path for you that I think you're going to prosper in. So I really want to commend you. I know there are many summer programs available, and this could be an example to other faculty members to, you know, be on the lookout for those kinds of programs, because many of the programs that are out there have some financial aid available to students who are deserving. So I'd love to see many more of our students taking advantage of these summer opportunities, because as Colby pointed out, it's an opportunity to meet other students from around the country and bring some of that experience back to Somerset and Berkeley. And that in and of itself can be a benefit to our students. So congratulations to you both.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think this is an example, this is the second example that we've seen, because we had Mrs. Troutman also introduced two students that did a program at UMass Dartmouth. Mm-hmm. So I want to say thank you, Mr. Chase, again, and congratulations, Colby. I think these are wonderful examples, so I'm glad that we have them at the start of these meetings. So congratulations.
Thank you.
And I also read that your parents were extremely supportive of your participating in the program, so congratulations to them. They have very good reason to be very proud of you. Thank you. And George snapped you up as a correspondent for The Spectator.
Yes. Same.
She does an excellent job.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
So now, again, we're pleased to welcome representatives of DECA, fresh off great success. So I'm going to ask our student representative, Kara Canoose, who's also, I believe, co-president of DECA, to kind of take the lead in introducing everyone who's here, and then feel free to let us
know. So my name is Kara Canoose, and I am one of the co-presidents of DECA. My other co-president, Sarah Wilson, she had work or gymnastics, a meet or something. So then we have the vice presidents.
I'm Guy Pareto, the co-vice president. Michael Gagliardi was unable to attend tonight, so stand in for both of us.
And I'm Michael Ferrara. I'm the treasurer here for DECA.
I'm Abigail Catterett. I'm co-fundraising chair.
I'm Jillian Levesque. I'm co-fundraising chair. And we also have Elizabeth McDonald, who is another fundraising chair who could not be here because she has gymnastics as well.
I'm Megan McDonald. I'm not a representative, but I won first place in my competition.
I'm Bruce Sedell, and I as well won first place in my competition at the first one.
We have a presentation up here.
And we hope you like us.
Oh yes, we also enjoy this. Oh, and one more person we have also on our team, Connor Ryder. He sends out all of our tweets, runs our Twitter page, and he's just our social media correspondent.
Yes, we'll be talking about Colin later in our meeting, actually.
Oh, his twin.
He's a man of many talents.
Colin and Connor are twins.
Oh, okay.
So there's two of them. So we just like to start off with thank you for allowing us to go to this district conference. We sent in 121 students, two on one day, and then a bunch on the second day. And we also were so lucky to have our two students that went on their first trip and came first place with us. So this is just an overview of what happened at districts and what we continue to move on to states, what will happen. We created this video about districts, so I'm just going to play it.
open, the crowd screams out, screaming your name. Hope if everybody runs, you choose to stay. Hope that you fall in love and it hurts so bad.
Gallarducci's house the night before. I think there was about 20 kids at 9 o'clock. About the atmosphere of districts, we were about 1/4, I would say, of the whole competition. We had a section filled with more than 100 kids, and you could hear, you could tell when the awards ceremony went on that we were a big influence in that competition. We kept on hearing Somerset Berkley, Somerset Berkley. So to continue on to the presentation.
We also competed against schools of Taunton, Stoughton, Oliver Ames, King Philip, Foxborough, Bristol Plymouth, Cats Academy. There's a bunch of other schools that do compete, but also we are, like Kara said, pretty much 1/4 of everybody that are in there. So that's an amazing feeling to hear that when we do like place, it's awesome to hear, and from Somerset Berkley and then the competitor, because you know that we're just really doing a good job, which is awesome.
All right, to run through some of these numbers, we held our annual calendar raffle sale that we've been doing for the last couple of years. And we raised $4,500, which was a good turnout. The jewelry sales, like we've been doing in the past as well, with a total of $4,000 there. The school store, so far this year, we've raised $4,000, split with a program to help local students in need. But that is the share that we have gained from it so far, showing, you know, it's really been a successful course. We've made it, we've taken the advantage with it, and we really made it work for us. But in total, DECA currently has a balance of $14,112, which, you know, for this time of the year, we've been doing really good, and we're off to a good start as far as that goes.
So this year at districts, we had 121 students entered into the competition. Typically, half of this number moves on to the state competition. So last year, we had 49% of our students made it to states, and this year, 56% of our students made it to states, and another 3 are also attending to compete in quiz bowl.
All right, and the winners are, is what it's titled, because that's all that we kept hearing. It was an amazing feeling. So we did have Maisie and Grace attend on the 10th. So they came, and both of them placed first place, which they'll get to talk about their experience after this. But then on the second day, on the 11th, we had 68 students. 68 students move on to the state competition, which is an awesome thing to do. So here's all of them in the places. So from all the categories, the top 6 move on. So we are lucky enough to have all of these people advance, including all of us right here. And first year, first place, here's Maisie Magoni and Grace Sitta.
Hi, I'm Maisie Magoni. I'm a sophomore here at the high school. When I joined DECA, I was a little bit nervous, but I didn't put much thought into it. And then about a month before I competed, Mrs. Ayer informed me that Grace and I would be going by ourselves the day before everybody else. Then I was really scared. In the car, I tried not to be as scared as I really was on the inside, but when I got there, I felt a little bit better. I went in, I competed, I tried my best, and that was really all I could do at that point. I didn't even think I would make it to place. When my name got called that I made it to states, I was happy enough. And then they start from 6th place and go on up. And when the 2nd place winner got called, I looked at Mrs. Ayer and I think I said, oh my gosh. it was a really great feeling, and I felt extremely accomplished, and I really thank Mrs. Ayer the guild and everybody up here for helping me and supporting me. And hopefully I do just as well at States.
Hi, my name is Grace Sedell. I'm also a sophomore at Somerset Berkley. And when I first wanted, I wanted to join DECA, but I only wanted to join just to say that I did it, you know, like, hey, I joined DECA, that's cool, isn't it? And I didn't really give that much dedication, or you could say decacation, into the program. And I was, at one point, so stocked up with all the homework that I had that I decided, maybe I should just quit. I emailed Miss Ayer about this whole spiel about how, you know what, maybe this isn't right for me. And she emailed me back, I think a couple hours later, saying, Grace, I know this is right for you. You have to give it a second chance, and I promise you it'll be worth it in the end. And here I am going to districts. And I think a week later, I move on to state, to districts, sorry. And to find out that I got a 99 on my word play, which counts twice for your score. And to think how I, a week later, was not even thinking, DECA went over my head, and here I am now moving on to States. And I'm especially grateful for Miss Ayer for not only convincing me to do this and moving on to States happy and excited, but also for encouraging everyone on this after school program. More than just an after school program, it's so much fun. I'm so happy to be a part of it. Thank you.
We also had a lot, we had a few more sophomores make it, which is really cool. It's their first year and they're already making on to States, so that was really exciting.
So we would also like to talk about something new that we're going to be doing in preparation for States. So we've decided to create a mock DECA competition, which will hopefully help both prepare our students, get all the jitters out, and get some more experience with doing role plays, and also inform some of the volunteer judges on what DECA is really about and how to judge, because at the district competition there was a shortage of judges, and we had some problems, but we got through it, and they even recruited some of our own chaperones, such as Mrs. Canoose, who was lovely enough to judge that day. So
everybody but the bus driver. And last year,
30 people. The day before, they had too many.
Yeah.
30 people. It was literally everybody but the bus driver that they dragged in to judge.
So we'd like to have our volunteer judges provide tips and criticism to the 68 competitors that will be participating in the mock DECA role play. And if any of you are interested, please let us know. We would be more than happy to have you. So we would like to use this next year prior to the district competition to even help us gain our numbers of going to States next year. And the main reason for doing this is because it's a little bit overwhelming to have 28 kids at the Gillard Gucci's house the night before. And we're so grateful for them, but we know that it would be great to have other people involved too. So.
And going off of what Jillian was just saying, this event would really help to show everybody in the community of what we really do. Because that's a huge thing, is that everybody kind of asks us, what is DECA and what we really do. So it would be awesome just to show that everybody, this is how we do it. And we can even have people watching the role plays happening and seeing that this is how we do and this is what we're moving on. So we're definitely planning on trying to see if this event can take place on February 28th. We're definitely looking further into the organization of this event and seeing how this will help us. Taunton High School just did an event like this that they had everybody in their community come see it. So that's definitely something that we want to try to utilize and use for the future and use for this year.
So to run through the cost of attendance, it's going to be very similar to what it was last year with, you know, some minor adjustments as there will be throughout the years. Every night, regardless on the room you're in, because there are rooms of three and rooms of four, will be $227. We'll be there on Thursday and Friday night. It really comes down to whether you're in that room of three or you're in that room of four, which has been selected randomly. If you're in room of three, it'll be $151, room of four, $113, so a little cheaper. The cost of meals for everybody will come out to about $253, so that room of three will be $366, or that's the room of four. The room of three will be $404. Then we also have to have 9 chaperones attend, because there's a ratio for every 8 competitors that we bring, there needs to be a chaperone. So with that, $366 each, the total cost of the conference for everybody and the chaperones will be about $3,300.
Okay, so I'm just going to talk a little bit more about the state competition. So it's in Boston, and it's in March. It's the 8th through the 10th. We're going to leave school on the Thursday right after, maybe get dismissed a little early so we can get all ready. And then we'll be coming back the Saturday after awards. So what we do is Thursday night, we go up and we get debriefed based on what our competition times are. We go to our hotel rooms, we get everything settled in. Then on Friday, we actually have the competition. So we have two role plays for the competitors and all day is the Quiz Bowl team. So last year, our Quiz Bowl team did fairly well. They came in third place, which is, I think we only did that once before, gotten that far. So we're hoping to do that as well this year. And after our two role plays, we go to the DECA ceremony. There's just a big ceremony where they give out mini awards, so you find out if you placed in either your test or your role plays. So then after that, we have the DECA dance, DECA's Got Talent, all that fun stuff. And the next day, we'll have the grand awards ceremony, hoping to have many students make it onto Atlanta, Georgia Internationals. So is there any questions about what happens at States? No?
The calculation there of
3,301,
that's just for the 9 shot. That's just, yes. So have the students that are going been given forms and...
Not yet. The
since
you're one of the parents, the parent union is Tuesday,
next Tuesday night. We just got these figures today, this morning. And is that the cost for, that's the total inclusive cost per student is 253? Or that's, is it 253 plus the room?
Yeah, this is the competition cost right here.
I see.
253 is the competition fees, the
food, they feed us breakfast every day and lunch and dinner.
And the hotel is separate. It's two separate bills that I need to pay.
We have two chaperones that cost nothing. This is G and I, because we judge Thursday night and Friday. You have to pay for us?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know. I'll have to talk to Donna. I'm going to talk to Donna and get that cut.
For sure, they're worth it.
I thought we got
free. So are any of the fundraising proceeds applied to that?
The calendar raffle, if they sold all their calendars, which was $50 worth, these would be the differences in prices. So you can see it goes down significantly, like the triple.
That's not reflected. The $50 off is
if they sell the calendar.
It's not reflecting in that. That's the straight up prices. We didn't put that.
Okay. It says total cost to attend if sold calendars. Sorry.
Right. Oh, sorry about that. Pretty big block in the way.
So those would be the prices if their students sold the 50 calendars.
Exactly.
Not the $50 worth of calendars.
Exactly. So participating in the fundraising definitely will pay off for that. And then all of that comes out of our total fundraising costs that we've already fundraised for. And another huge.
I'm thinking Atlanta already. Like airplanes and no wheels included and things like that. So.
All right. And another huge thing is just to thank Mr. and Mrs. Gilagucci, Mr. Pierce, and I know Mrs. Field also judged at the competition. It was such an amazing thing.
Last year,
same thing. it's just awesome to see that members of our community are participating in something that we love so much, and it's great to see there's an incident that Mr. Gilagucci almost had grace, but they ended up switching. So you can always see a friendly face in there sometimes, but it's awesome just to see that, and we thank everybody here just for your support in general, so.
And lastly, we'd just like to ask your permission to attend the state competition in Boston.
So I was going to ask, perhaps Maisie and Grace or anyone else, if you prefer, to just explain how the competition worked, specifically your experience. I was a judge, and so were you both involved in the role play aspect of it? So if you could just tell us a little bit about the category that you were in, what the issues were that how much time you had to prepare, how long the role play went, so people can appreciate exactly what the experience is like.
So as an individual competitor, you have 10 minutes to prepare your role play. Teams have 30 minutes. So you're put in a room and then your proctor brings you to a separate room where you're given 10 minutes and they give you your role play.
So I set up my notes. You're given something called performance indicators. There's usually four. So you have to hit the points in your presentation to get the points for your role play. So I would write my performance indicator and then what I want to talk about underneath. So after that, after 10 minutes are up, your proctor brings you to your judge. You go in and introduce yourself and you ask to be seated. Then you present your problem to them. And then once you're done, you ask if they have any questions. I personally made a business card, which I think really helped me out. And so I gave it to my judge and then I was finished. My role play was to assume the role of a post office manager, and there was an angry customer that was mad that stamp prices went up. So I had to explain why the stamp prices went up and how I was going to fix it. My category is Principles of Business Management and Administration. So it was a very interesting topic, and I'm glad that I had something that I could, that my role play was something that I understood a little bit better. So
me and Maisie had to go a day before all the other kids went for their competition because our categories were principles of so-and-so, while theirs were just, for example, sports and entertainment marketing, where ours would be principles of sports and entertainment marketing. So, which is meant for first-time DECA competitors. My category was principles of hospitality and tourism, and although me and Maisie didn't get the full district's experience, instead of riding in a bus, we rode in a little car with Miss Ayer, but I still had so much fun, and my role play was to assume the role of a social media marketer, and I was hired by a restaurant to market their restaurant because they were losing money in sales and I had to promote them on social media. But the boss, who was my judge, did not believe in social media, and so I had to convince them. And I think I did fairly well, and like Maisie did, I also made a business card since it was Miss Ayer's idea to do so. And I have to say that did get us pretty far since we did both get first place.
So yeah, all the different role play scenarios vary across the different categories that you were in. So all of us had different scenarios and different categories. So it's definitely from our point of view that we have this and this is how we deal with the situation versus like a judge's point of view. So it was definitely an amazing experience for all of us across the board.
Thank you very much for coming in and telling us about your experience. I really enjoyed being there myself. I was there the second day and was judging presenters on corporate finance, and it was very interesting. I thought it was a very challenging topic, but you're here to ask us to approve your trip to Boston. We've done it in the past. But one of the questions I always ask is, you mentioned the number of chaperones. Is that the number that's required by DECA? Our policy says that the principal has to also sign off on the number of chaperones. Do you know if that's been done?
Actually, no, it hasn't been done.
Okay. So in the past.
Is new. It's always been 10 to 1. And DECA has upped the ante, so to speak. We are now at 8 to 1.
Okay.
So
we, in the past, we've approved it subject to the principal's sign-off, so I think we can do that tonight. I mean, this is a program that you've been participating in for many years, so, but I would like to, just to comply with our policy, just get the principal sign-off that he's satisfied with the number of chaperones. Okay. So I will entertain a motion to approve the request by DECA to participate in the state conference in March.
So who?
How did I know that you would be the one to make that motion, Mr. Gilarducci? Is there a second?
I'll second it, and that's pending principal approval.
Right.
I'll second it.
Okay. Any further discussion? Okay, in the absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Mrs. Terra?
Aye.
And I vote aye, so it's unanimous. And I again would just like to reiterate how much we appreciate all the support that both Mr. Gilarducci and Mrs. Gilarducci provide to DECA. I know I was sitting with them before the competition started, and they were talking about the number of students that were at their house the night before and talking about many individual students. And
you need a lot of Tate's chocolate chip cookies, goldfish, grapes, and whatever they can grab.
Well, your commitment to the program and to our students is really above and beyond, so we want to thank you as well for all you do.
And something that's very telling is I received an email from Jessica Fale, who is the advisor for Taunton. And Taunton is bigger than us in numbers. And all it said was, Chris, you crushed us.
Exactly. So, every single time that you heard it, it was always from Somerset Berkley. Every single category.
There was only one category, 19 categories?
Yeah.
One category, we only had one sophomore young man in it that we didn't take a place. That was it. Every category, we took something.
Great.
So when he said you crushed us, we did.
There they are.
Yes. Well, congratulations.
Well, and 70 of the 121 were brand new to decorations.
Yeah.
70 of them. So they're first timers. A lot of first timers are going. That doesn't usually happen. First time, first year is usually their learning year. They see what it's all about, and then they, okay, I got this. I got to do this again next year.
Well, my first year, I tied for fifth and top five on one. So we've made it far.
And every office made it.
Yep.
So you did a great job.
And how many judges do you need for this mock competition?
Well, it's funny you should ask. I have to push you down because remember, you remember you and I spoke about now the only thing left was you to look at teams, and we just happen to have four business law and ethics teams, which I thought you would be a great fit for. What do you think? I haven't really got that February 28th approved by David Lanziski yet, but.
Okay. Well, I certainly will do it if, assuming
this
I'm available. What day of the week? What day of the week?
This is the perfect arena right here, too, with all the individual tables, and this will be perfect. And then they didn't. The idea here, of course, is to get the jitters out for them because it's a week before the actual competition. Give them some more experience with larger numbers and real judges and whatever, but. To train some judges so that what happened this year doesn't happen. 30 judges didn't show up, and they aren't my 30 judges, but 30 judges didn't show up, and like I said, they were dragging people off the street. They were desperate. They had 1,000 kids there, and they can't compete if they don't have judges. So
sure.
This way, maybe we can get a pool of judges who know what they're doing and are trained by, because you know what you're doing now. It's about 15 minutes worth of training, I would say. But then there would be a pool. So if that happens, that someone cancels at the last minute, things happen, that we would have some people to draw on. Because we're expected to replace our own judges. It's 10 to 1 on judges. So if I have 100 kids, I have to send a judge for every 10 of them. And we're expected to replace our own judges if they drop out. So this way we would have a pool, maybe a nice rotation, and be able to have some people who understand what it's about and draw. Because the people, I'm sure Erin Knuse can say, she thought she was going there to chaperone and bring people to judges. And she ended up a judge. And miss the training, just here, sit here, kind of thing. So it wasn't easy. We want to try to avoid that happening again. And we plan to have refreshments in the student dining center afterwards, and something a little different. Instead, there's not going to be any winners, but this way, you as the judge can actually talk to the kids and explain. This is what I saw, this is what you did good, this is what you should work on, whatever it is, you can actually talk. Four would be the most, but I know you can handle it. You can handle four. Four would be the most. Some judges, it depends on the category, will only have two or three. That would be it. So we're looking at about maybe 15 judges. I think I have 11 solid right now. Right? And you're solid. I knew you would do it. And Jack is going to do it. We've done this whole crew.
Well, it's difficult to say no when you know how much time the Gilladucci's devote to the program.
Yeah, that's true.
Okay.
The one thing we have to say, they're wonderful because while they're role playing, they observe each other. There's no destructive criticism. Everything is constructive. And they have a camaraderie amongst them that they all work together and pull for each other, which is wonderful to see. And they have to be very proud because they work really well together.
Thank you. I'm bossing to them, but every year the team gets better and better. Every year.
Well, we should thank you as well because we know how much time you devote to this. So thank you.
It's a labor of love. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Oh, did we take a vote?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. I know we had the motion in the second. That's right. I said, that's right, so we're all set. Okay, so Carrot, the next item on the agenda, do you have a report this evening?
I do, I have a few bullet points of what's happened. So the first thing I'm gonna talk about is show choir. So me as well as Alex Celia, Jonas Swaman, Kevin Correa, we all are like the head of show choir, we're the leaders in the group. And we just had our first competition at Lowell High School. And we got a silver medal, and we beat our last year's score. Last year we got a bronze, so that was very exciting. Everyone loves our story and our new show, and we're really excited to move forward because we did place so high and did so well. We beat one of our top competitors that we've never beaten before, so that was pretty cool.
What school was that?
Oliver Ames High School. So then we just talked a lot about DECA, but we had a competition. We're on the States. Okay, so the school store, what happened in December was we had this big sale and we basically sold out of everything. We had a mad rush of parents come in there and it was right before the holidays, so everyone wanted to get gifts. But now we've restocked, we've got new items in, we have headbands. I just myself just bought a crew neck sweatshirt. We have many new items. To talk about, we had Chris Heron come in and he did an amazing job. I just sat there and like cried. Because it was so powerful. Everyone seemed to love it and it was so real. Like the reason that we've had a lot of talks about how you shouldn't do drugs and how you shouldn't get into that stuff, but Chris really made it real and put it on a personal level that connected to every student in the gym, and it was a lot of students in the gym. To talk about sports, well, so we have the basketball teams, we have the track team, we have the hockey team, we have the gymnastics team, there's probably more than I'm forgetting. But just one thing that I found pretty fun, maybe you could make it a fundraiser someday, so I figured I'd talk about it, is I'm not sure if you know about Celtics Bingo, but I play Celtics Bingo with my friends Jill and Autumn, she just left, almost every Celtics game, and it's just basically a bingo card and it says like, Tatum got 2 points or something, the Celtics hit a layup, so we created a Raiders Bingo that we just play on our own, but maybe it would be a fundraiser, so we put like Raiders layup, Raiders made both free throws, stuff like that, Raiders win, and it was pretty fun. We all got bingo, we didn't get like a blackout of the card, but maybe next game, there's one tomorrow, so I don't know, maybe that could be a fundraiser. So also talk about the Breeze, they're doing so well, I love reading their articles, I have their notifications on my phone, so every time there's a new article, it pops up. And every Wednesday they do the morning announcements, which I think is pretty cool. So they go on the speaker and they do the pledge and they talk about all the announcements that usually I think it's Miss Farias would do, they do instead. So the debate team, I just talked to Mr. Chase all about the debate team. They had their first meet and they swept at ORR. I think that means that they won every part of the competition. I'm not really sure about debate. But also a shout out to Ryan Silverman. He wanted to say that he did really good, and Mr. Chase is the coach. Also, we have this is my last point. We have the National Honor Society induction happening next Wednesday, and I will be there I'm the secretary of National Honor Society, so I'll be talking about leadership, which is one of the four pillars. We're welcoming some juniors and seniors in with I think it's above a 3.5 average GPA, and they have the 20 hours of community service, so that's exciting. We also have the president, Sydney Miss, talking about scholarship,
the Vice President Gina talking about service and the Treasurer Gemma Bruce talking about character. So those are the four main pillars of our chapter, and that's what will be happening next Wednesday. Did I touch everything? Is there any questions about what's happening at the school?
A lot of good stuff.
Yeah.
Good. Thank you very much.
No problem.
So next item we have Chromebook implementation, plan update, and the superintendent's report. I know that we were going to have Ms. Levesque here to talk about the Chromebook implementation, but unfortunately he had a death in his family, and so he's not available tonight, and we want to express our condolences to him. I know his mother was sick for a time, and she passed away last week, so we want to express our sincere sympathy to him at his loss. So Mr. Schoonover, maybe you can just touch on that as part of your superintendent's report.
Sure.
And he did share. Follow up with Mr. Levesque at another meeting if necessary.
Okay. I know the question came up either at our last meeting or the one prior to that about vandalism at the school relative to Chromebooks. So I did speak with Mr. Levesque. He shared the numbers with me. We own 1,080 Chromebooks total. We have about 1,005 students right now. So some of those are the newly purchased Chromebooks. Some are one that were devices that were originally purchased with the building. So far, once the rollout happened in early November, we've had 10 repairs for accidental, 10 accidental claims for repairs, and we've had 2 incidents of vandalism. So those are the numbers. It's about 99% of the devices have had nothing wrong with them at all, but those were the numbers. And I know, Mrs. Terry, you had mentioned that. I'm not sure if there's additional information that you were looking for, but if so, I can get that and ask Mr. Levesque for a future meeting.
But I think it's important. You mentioned this to me, Mr. Schooner. I think it's important because I think some of the information that went out was created a false impression. And I heard from Mr. Larrabee that there was discussion in Berkeley about it. In both of the situations where there was vandalism, as I understand it, the students who were involved were seen on our security system.
Yes.
And both acknowledged the incident, and both have made restitution.
Yes.
So I think that's very important for people to know. But I'm sorry, Melissa, did you have...
that was my thing. I wanted people to know that there is some consequences to vandalism, so I wanted to make sure we had that in our policy, that it wasn't just being... the insurance was being kind of abused or taken advantage of. And I apologize if Berkeley misunderstood that message, but I thought it was pretty clear, and I think we do owe it to people to be transparent about that stuff and be good stewards and teach our students to be good stewards of these Chromebooks.
I have a question about the Chromebooks.
Sure.
Are the senior ones going to be replaced for the freshmen with new ones, or?
That's not currently the plan, but I was actually speaking with some seniors today about the Chromebooks. I understand the ones that you have, and maybe you can share your experience here. How's the battery life on yours?
They don't last, probably about an hour they last.
Wow.
I'm not exaggerating either. So I come into school, and if I were to take notes in my anatomy class, which would be all block for an hour, it would go down significantly, probably about to 20%. And once it hits that 20%, it basically doesn't work. It just slows down. So some of them, a lot of my friends use their computers all the time, though, because they work so well. But I think maybe there's just a few of them, maybe the older ones. Do we have older ones? I'm not even sure. But
well, the ones that seniors have were all purchased at the same time.
Oh, okay.
But some may have been used more than others. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. It's just the battery life isn't... they're slower, but we can work with, so that's fine. It's just the main issue is the battery life.
So with that, how's that being handled? So would a student need to let someone know so that could be checked out? Because that might not even be an insurance issue, it might just be a defect.
We have spare Chromebooks because we do have about 75 or so more than we have students in the building. So if there is a significant problem there, if it really doesn't hold a charge, you can turn that into the technology department and they can give you another one with a better battery. And then at this point, whether we replace batteries on those old devices and reinvest the money or, you know, we'd have to weigh whether or not that's is worth the investment on a four-year-old, five-year-old device.
So how are students communicated with if this is happening or a problem? Where do they go?
They go to the technology department.
To be completely honest, a lot of the seniors, we don't use our Chromebooks in class. Maybe it's because that's just how we've had all throughout 4 years. The freshmen, I walk by their classrooms, especially the world language, and they're always on the computer. But in my experience, I don't use the computer at all. I'm in two math classes though, so that's, we don't really use the computers for math. Whenever I need to do stuff for DECA, I just use Ms. Ayer's laptop. So that might be something that we're not seeing a lot of battery issues coming up to the technology department because we don't use them as much as the other grades. That might just be us.
Let's make sure students are encouraged that this is happening. I hate to see them not be able to take notes in class and it's just, you know, keep shutting down, or, you know, they're plugging in constant electricity when it's something that could be easily fixed. I'm just wondering if kids know if this is happening or if teachers know, direct it right to technology to replace them.
When I'm in the technology office, there are students and teachers frequently come and go with questions, problems, whatever the case may be, whether it's Chromebook related or not. People know that they can go there for help. And teachers certainly,
teachers
know that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Okay, I want to give a winter athletics participation update. I did the same thing in fall really before school started. Just so we continue to look at those numbers this year, particularly with user fees. In the fall, if you recall, this was really the first week of athletics in August. I reported that we had 324 student athletes, and which was exactly the same number as the previous fall. Ultimately, during the fall season, we did lose seven athletes, for various reasons, dropped off their team, so we finished with 317. Right now, for winter sports, last year we had for boys, we had 118 boys participating in basketball, ice hockey, indoor track, and wrestling. To this date, we have 118 boys participating in winter sports, exactly the same numbers last year. For girls, on the girls' teams, basketball, ice hockey, co-op, indoor track, cheerleading, and gymnastics, last year we had 113 students. This year we have 120. So we have seven more currently in winter sports than we had last year. So through two seasons, with the seven student drop that we had in the fall, we are at the exact same number of participants from fall and winter of the 16-17 school year to fall winter of the school year. Speaking of athletics, today we had a really nice event take place in the gymnasium after school. Somerset Middle School was supposed to host Berkley Middle School today at Somerset Middle School. But we worked it out. We tried to get it going last year and it didn't happen. But Somerset hosted Berkley Middle here at the high school. So it was really nice. We had a huge crowd of Berkley and Somerset parents and fans. It looked like a varsity basketball game on a Friday night. We had so many people there. But it was great to have the middle school students come and play together on the floor that they will likely be playing on next year as one team. So anyway, it was a great event and hope that we can encourage that and have Berkley and Somerset play here every year if we can work it out with the the winter schedule with the high school sports.
Is that new?
Mm-hmm. It was the first time.
Oh, it's the first time they've done it here?
Yes. So they started the season, they opened up against each other in Berkley. This game was originally supposed to be on January 3rd at Somerset Middle, but we managed to get it here. It was a nice event. As you know, at this point, I originally had this in my update for you on January 4th. Mr. Marshall has been appointed the Fine Performing Arts Content Coordinator. Just so you know, we did have 11 applicants for the position. We had a team of music and art teachers and building principals, central office staff, who participated in the interviews. I had two outstanding candidates, but in the end, Mr. Marshall and his experience in Somerset and Somerset Berkley, and the passion that he works with. I think we've all seen Mr. Marshall perform, and he has such a passion for music, and was very clear in the interviews that he was going to bring that passion not just to music, keep it in music, but also expand it to art and really have it as a K-12 position. He does officially start that role on January 26th, which is the start of the second semester. I was going to mention Chris Heron's presentation. We're very fortunate to have him last Monday. Kara did a nice job talking about that. And just to echo what Kara said, there were about 1,100 people in the gym between the students and the adults. You could hear a pin drop for the hour and a half that he was presenting, whether it was the video that he started out with or his presentation, and then the questions and answers afterwards. It was absolutely powerful. And with several students approaching him at the end and hugging him in front of the entire student body because they were moved so much by it. So it was a really strong message that he delivered, and I know that he was receiving emails from our students that evening as well, which we learned about and he shared with us. But it really had a big impact on a lot of kids.
Was that a funded program?
It was. His normal cost is $1,500 to do a presentation like that. Mm-hmm. I had worked with someone who was going to fund it, and Chris did it at no charge.
Wow, that's great.
The benefactor who was going to fund it still gave a donation to the Heron Project. But Chris decided that Somerset Berkley, I think, was the last high school in the area that he had not been to, and decided to do it at no cost. And he talked about how his wife is a graduate of Somerset High School. He talked about being married at St. Thomas More and his connection to Somerset, playing Pottersville as a child and so on. So, he was very very generous and not charging us for it. That same week, last week, on Tuesday night, we had Karen Kraut come from Mass General Hospital's Think Kids program. So she talked about this problem-solving, it's a collaborative problem-solving approach. She gave a presentation to the Distance Learning Center and talked about the, a lot of times when, this is really geared for, obviously, for parents, and when working with students who have challenging behavior issues, it's really understanding that there is a skills gap. So a certain demand is being made on a student or a child, and the child just doesn't have the skills to really reach the expectations. So she was talking to parents on how describing the process and showed a video that she had about just trying to close that gap and then working with the students to build up the skills afterwards. She followed up this week with an email with me with a number of resources, which I will make sure that I share with the committee afterwards.
I would just like to mention that I went to the presentation, at least a part of the presentation. We had a meeting here that night, so some of us who attended weren't there at the very beginning, but it was the second time that I had attended a presentation that she had done. I found it extremely valuable, and it's a little disappointing at the turnout of parents who really did not take advantage. It's our effort at creating a parent academy and providing really worthwhile presentations for parents, and the number of parents that were there, I think the parents who were there really appreciated the presentation and took a great deal away from it, but there were many, many empty seats that could have been filled by parents who I'm sure are dealing with these issues. I think it was well publicized. I don't know how we generate more interest and support for a program like this, but it's too bad that more people didn't really take advantage of it.
I have a question. Mm-hmm. Was it posted? I know I'm in this. There's like a Berkeley parents Facebook page. Was anything posted in there? Because everyone's always posting there, I'm not sure.
So that's a good question. This came up with something else recently, actually with our kindergarten registrations. We do not have a Facebook account for the school department. So that is something that I'm going to create one. That way we can get the word out to parents about registering for kindergarten, but use it for other things like that.
Really,
it was on Twitter. It went out to parents on the one call emails. I shared it with different groups, our Somerset-based group and so on, and then got that message out that way, but not on Facebook. But thank you, Karen.
Okay. Did you have anything else?
I'm all set. Thank you.
Okay. All right. So, under budget and finance matters, approval of final bond issue of $2,561 and $2,561,289. Mrs. Albanez.
So we had our we had our final bonding to close out the building project today. We went for an amount of $2,561,289, which the total project costs minus the MSBA reimbursement, minus the bonding amounts that we have bonded to date, indicated the $2.5 million. We did receive a 2.98% interest rate for a 20-year bond. So what you have in your packet that I brought with me tonight is basically just a synopsis of our bonding amounts to date. We have five separate ones. I indicated the interest rates that have been earned on those five. So you can see that we stayed under the 3% for four of our bonding issuances. And also the maturity dates range from September of 2034 to June 1st of 2039. So they're staying pretty much in the same time frame as far as expiration is concerned, with a five-year difference at the most. So I think it was a pretty good interest rate that we received. I was happy to get under the 3% mark, considering market conditions. Also on this spreadsheet is the original project budget of $82,383,618. The actual project came in at $79,603,903 for an under budget total of $2,779,715. Of the 79,603,903, like I had indicated, we've received 46,509,114 from the Mass School Building Authority for this project, which required a total financing cost of 33,094,789. So that is essentially the final financing for this building project. So, Mr. Pierce, you have vote language that does have to be read and voted on tonight by the school committee so that we can issue the final documents for this bond issuance.
I just have a question. It indicates the rate is 2.98%. That's an average?
No, that's the actual.
So
that's the true interest rate.
So can you explain why it says that the bonds are issued at 5% and 3%?
That could be the range of how the interest is paid against the principal on a year-to-year basis, but the actual interest rate over the life of the bond is going to be 2.98%.
And what rating did we get on this particular issuance? Is it the same rating that we had on the previous issues, or did it change?
It's the same rating that we've had.
Okay. Are there any other questions? All right, because it is a bond issue, we do have to read the vote, so bear with me. The proposed vote is that the sale of $2,561,289 state-qualified general obligation school bonds with the district dated February 1, 2018, the bonds to Raymond James and Associates, Inc. at the price of $2,639,865.79 and accrued interest, if any, is hereby approved and confirmed. The bond shall be payable on February 1 of the years and in the principal amounts and bear interest at the respective rates as follows. 2019, $86,289 at 5% interest. 2020, $90,000, 5% interest rate. 2021, $95,000, 5% interest rate. 2022, $95,000, 5% interest rate. 2023, $100,000, 5% interest rate. 2024, $105,000, 5% interest rate. 2025, $110,000, 5% interest rate. 2026, $120,000, 5% interest rate. 2027, $125,000, 3% interest rate. 2028, $130,000, 3% interest rate. 2029, $130,000, 3% interest rate. 2030, $135,000, 3% interest rate. 2031, $140,000, 3% interest rate. 2032, $145,000, 3% interest rate. 2033, $150,000, 3% interest rate. 2034, $155,000, 3% interest rate. 2035, $155,000, 3% interest rate. 2036, $160,000, 3% interest rate. 2037, $165,000, 3% interest rate. And 2038, $170,000, 3.125% interest rate. Further voted that in connection with the marketing and sale of the bonds, the preparation and distribution of a notice of sale and preliminary official statement dated January 11, 2018, and an official statement dated January 18, 2018, the official statement, each in such form as may be approved by the district treasurer, be and hereby are ratified, confirmed, approved, and adopted. Further voted that the bonds shall be subject to redemption at the option of the district upon such terms and conditions as set forth in the official statement. Further voted that the district treasurer and the chair of the committee be and hereby are authorized to execute and deliver a continuing disclosure undertaking in compliance with SEC Rule 15C2-12 in such form as may be approved by bond counsel to the district, which undertaking shall be incorporated by reference in the bonds for the benefit of the holders of the bonds from time to time. Further voted that we authorize and direct the district treasurer to establish post-issuance federal tax compliance procedures in such form as the district treasurer and bond counsel deem sufficient, or if such procedures are currently in place, to review and update said procedures in order to monitor and maintain the tax-exempt status of the bonds. Further voted that each member of the committee, the district secretary, and the district treasurer be and hereby are authorized to take any and all such actions and execute and deliver such certificates, receipts, or other documents as may be determined by them or any of them to be necessary or convenient to carry into effect the provisions of the foregoing votes. I will entertain a motion to that effect.
So moved. Second.
Motion by, made by Mrs. Terra and seconded by Mrs. Gagliardi. Is there any further discussion? In the absence of further discussion, we'll have a roll call. Call Mr. Giliducci.
Aye.
Mrs. Gagliardi.
Aye.
Mrs. Terra.
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Okay. Budget subcommittee update. Mrs. Gagliardi.
We met this last week and reviewed a very preliminary budget. We had looked at, and I don't have those dates for you. We looked at having a budget
workshop. I'm not.
Oh, so we have we have another meeting next week to review it, and then we're planning a budget workshop for the entire committee to review that. I don't have that date with me. I apologize for that.
I don't think we set the workshop date.
We didn't.
Yeah. We just scheduled next Thursday.
Okay, so upon looking at it, we're going to try to schedule a workshop for the entire committee. I think later on in the agenda, we're going to be looking at dates in January and February, and so I think we're going to play with some of our existing school committee dates to possibly have the workshop piggyback on that.
So next Thursday? It's not official.
Well, I suggest that we move that item because the reason I put the the matter on the agenda is because we missed a meeting the first week of January, so we moved this meeting up from next week to this week because we have some items that are somewhat time sensitive, and I would like us to consider what our meeting schedule is going to be for January and February, because that's going to be much of the time within which we'll be working on the budget as well as the superintendent's evaluation. So we did have a meeting scheduled for next Thursday, which we would like to now schedule as a budget subcommittee meeting. And what is our, that would have been the 25th. What is our next scheduled meeting, Robin, after the 25th?
The 15th.
February 15th.
Okay. Two agenda items. We were going to do the budget workshop and superintendent evaluation. Yes. That was one consideration. So we have two meetings.
So that's actually, and then, is that the week before school vacation?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
But I was hoping that we could schedule a budget workshop earlier than the 15th.
So we need to do it prior to the net spending meeting that they're going to have on the 13th.
I'm sorry, the next what?
Berkeley's having that net spending meeting on the 13th. Does it have to be done prior to that?
It doesn't have to be, okay. But I'm concerned about progress on the budget, and we do have the 1st and the 8th Thursdays. So I'd like to see if perhaps we could schedule a meeting, a school committee meeting on either the 1st or the 8th for a budget workshop.
Should we send, because there's only four of us here, should we ask if we can get it, send out a doodle poll? I mean, I can make either the 1st or the 8th, but I don't know, is that okay?
Yeah, we should send out a doodle poll for the others.
Does that, do both those days work for administration or no? Because I know you have other meetings, they do work.
I prefer the 8th, but
Yeah, I can just go at limits as well. This is our place.
So we could send something out to see if everybody can make it on the 8th.
Yes.
Is that okay?
Yeah. The only thing on the 8th right now, we just approved use of the Performing Arts Center on the 8th. We're going to have a town hall style meeting with the new owners of Brayton Point.
Okay.
So Representative Pat Haddad has requested to use the PAC that night, but I think by the sounds of it, they're expecting it to be over by 6:30, 7 o'clock.
Oh, okay.
I'm not sure of that.
But we would have the meeting in here.
We would have it here, right. Like, I'm just not sure if any school committee members would want to, or other members would want to attend that.
Yeah, you want everyone at this meeting, right?
Right. Could we make it our start at 7? Is that possible?
Well, let me get the details of that meeting, because we also have the 1st as a possibility. So. All right, we'll look at the schedule and we'll send out.
Robin, can you include Mr. Levesque and the directors in the doodle poll, please?
I mean, I think since it's about a budget, and if Mrs. Alvarez feels that he works better in her schedule, I think we should accommodate that as first priority. And then have first as a backup. Mm-hmm.
Look, I didn't hear. Did you express a preference?
Yeah. Yes, she did. For the 8th.
I prefer the 8th, but I really want the other directors to weigh in because they really should be present for that as well.
Mm-hmm.
If they can, if we do a doodle poll. So.
Okay. I'm just thinking the doodle poll will help us figure that out a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So basically, we did look at it. Our plan is to meet next week, do a little bit more work on it, answer some questions, and then have a budget workshop in the very near future.
where we can present where we stand with, to the whole committee.
So next week, the subcommittee?
Yes.
Okay. And then the maybe the first or the eighth, preferably the eighth.
Exactly.
Okay, so we'll move on to approval of monthly invoices. Does anyone have any
questions? I have a quick question, sorry. For the March meeting, that's the night of, I'm pretty sure it's March 8th, that's the night of DECA, and so I will be going to that. And my vice president, he's also going to DECA, so I'm not sure who you would like to attend in our place.
Ooh. March 8th, I will be in DECA also, because we do the reading and then the judge, the reading on Thursday, judging on Friday.
Can we look to reschedule that meeting possibly to the following week?
Well, we have we do have a meeting scheduled on the 22nd.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So I would say maybe the 1st rather than the 15th.
Mm-hmm. Do it earlier.
Well, right. Just move it up a week rather than having meetings two consecutive weeks.
I was just thinking of the kids.
Let us take a look at that, because we're going to have a public hearing on our budget in March. And I really don't, we'll have to see when we can schedule the last week of the month is not the best time for us to have.
No, what he's saying is the March 1st have our school committee.
I understand, but when would the next meeting be?
The next the one is the 22nd.
So we could do the budget meeting on the 1st, mm-hmm. and then the public hearing between the 8th and the 15th, one of those two dates, if you wanted to have a separate meeting for the public hearing, or just roll it into the... Historically, we've had a separate meeting for the public hearing.
Generally, in most years, we've approved the final budget after the public hearing, I think. But it does give us a little time in the event that we needed to have another meeting before the end of March, mm-hmm. before it has to be approved by April 1st, correct? Mm-hmm. Has to be certified by April 1st?
April
30th. April 30th? Mm-hmm.
April
30th? Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I think if we can send that out, so
April 30th.
It has to be voted by March 31st, but it's
that's what I saw. Yeah.
Certified by the Treasury by the 30th.
Okay. And the meeting that is scheduled on the 8th right now is supposed to be at Berkley Middle.
Okay, so that gives us limited time too. Okay, so the first one, then we would move March 1st to Berkley Middle.
Okay. If that were right. To be the decision, right?
Should we send out those dates, perhaps?
Yeah, I think we need to look at the overall schedule and try to piece it together, so we'll send that out. All right, so I don't know. We were on approval of monthly invoices. Did we resolve that? I asked if there were any questions. I don't think we had a vote to approve the monthly invoices.
I'll make a motion to approve the monthly invoices.
Is there a second?
Second.
All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
I abstain because I didn't get it via email first, and I don't have time to go through all of them. But I like them ahead of time.
All right, well, we have a quorum and we need a majority vote. So the chair votes aye, so three in the affirmative and one abstention. So they're approved. Next, policy updates, including policy revisions based on Massachusetts Association of School Committees recommendations. Second reading, policies ACE, EB, EDC, EFC, KCD, JFBB, JLCB, JLCC, IB, IC, / ICA, IE, IHA, IHAI.
Motion to waive the details.
Well, I think we should just announce which specific policies we're voting on. So if there's no real objection, let me just finish reading these. I'm almost done. IHB, IHBH, IJOB, DD, CBD, CBI, CE, CH, CHA, CHC, BDE, BF, BDF, BEDA, BEDH, and BIBA. These policies were all previously presented. Everyone on the committee has the redlined versions, and I would entertain a motion to approve all of these policy changes as a group, unless any individual committee member wishes to remove any one individual policy for discussion and separate vote. Hearing none, then I will entertain a motion to approve the group of policies as previously approved at first reading.
Sharon Pierce, I just had a question. In reviewing them, there was one in particular, I'm just going to go to it, in regards to, and it was a minor issue, was had to do with evaluation of the superintendent. The bullets seem to be repetitive, so I'm just wondering if it is evaluation of the superintendent, CBI, and it says it has three bullets, through evaluation of the superintendent.
Could you wait just a minute? Okay. Because all right.
It says, through evaluation of the superintendent, the school committee will strive to accomplish the following, and then it has four bullets, actually. Ensure the efforts of the superintendent are focused on district goals and standards of professional practice established by the state regulation are met by the superintendent. Two, ensure all committee members and the superintendent are in agreement and clear on the role of the superintendent and the immediate priorities among his or her responsibilities. Three, provide excellence in administrative leadership of the school district. And then four says, provide administrative leadership of excellence for the school. And those two, to me, seem like they were the exact same thing, especially in the case that we only have one building, unless I'm reading it differently or incorrectly. Was there a...
I'm reading the MASC policy that's online. Would you like me to read the one that's here? For the number four is not the same that
I just read
from MASC that you just read.
And that's what it looks like on this marked up version. So okay. That's why I'm bringing that up. See, is that how it reads to you or am I reading it? It says circled four reads very much like number three on the version that I have.
All right, then what I suggest is that we remove this from consideration, refer it back to the policy subcommittee, and move forward on all of the other policy changes.
Except CBI.
Okay.
So we will remove CBI from consideration this evening, refer it back to the policy subcommittee, and motion will relate to all the other policies. So had a motion and a second.
Yes.
And any further discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous.
Well, I didn't have any issues with some of the others. I thought it was interesting to reread the policy on instructional on the program of studies, because you can see that it's in a continuation of an older policy when they talk about civics in class and things like that, so I thought that was interesting. I don't know if we really have that embedded, but required for all students?
It's what we have for civics is embedded within the social studies curriculum within courses, but not a standalone course.
Yeah. Maybe someday.
That's too bad, because I enjoyed that.
Yeah, I think like that mm-hmm. was fast. Mm-hmm. All right, thank you.
Okay. The next item we have is citations for Eagle Scouts, and
we have
Oh, I'm sorry. You're right. So, next item is superintendent's evaluation, progress and accomplishments. Mr. Schoonover.
Okay, thank you. I did share earlier today a live binder, a digital portfolio, if you will, of summaries, reflections, and some evidence for each of the five goals and each of the four standards for superintendents. So you have access to that. So I know there will be some time between tonight and when the committee members have to submit and fill out the superintendent rubric and the other instrument tool. So you have this information now in a digital format, and I'm sure if anyone prefers a paper copy, we can get that for you as well. Mm-hmm. For the professional practice goal, which is creating a positive district climate by building strong internal and external relationships to support student achievement through a high level of administrative visibility, providing timely communication with families and staff to ensure that they are well informed about the district goals, initiatives, and accomplishments. So some of the things that I have provided here, some of the ways that I wanted to expand communication this past year, including some family newsletters. Really, it's a link to a site on the Somerset Schools website where I've been putting these communications to families. As you can see, just several of the examples that are there, newsletters beginning last May and then continuing this year, as well as just a few other what I thought were timely memos that needed to go out to parents. In addition to that, I started creating a staff newsletter. Usually on my goal ultimately is on a monthly basis. It's but so far it's been about quarterly, and you know, there are different messages that I share. The one most recently in October, I talked about some research that I found relevant and very interesting by John Hattie in terms of learning objectives and making sure that teachers are clearly communicating the intentions of a lesson and circling back to that and just how important that is for student achievement. There's an example of the April letter here, which has just some policy updates. I wanted to make sure that this followed the school committee's approval of the 504 policy update, as well as the bullying prevention and intervention policy back in March. So I made sure to communicate that just shortly after that to all staff with links to the information so they could find that and refer to that. I talked about the district strategy, which also had been recently approved by the Somerset Berkley School Committee, and just sharing that information with staff, as well as having some articles and resources that I come across recently that I thought were relevant for different things, conversations that had been taking place. So that was one way that I wanted to build that communication with faculty. I did have and spoke about the Parent Academy, and included the flyer. You all know that, and many of you attended at least some of those last year. It was a way, and Mr. Pierce talked about the attendance that we've had. I also would love to see more parents attend some of these, but it's not anything that we offered before. So while I would love to have the Distance Learning Center or the Performing Arts Center packed with parents and faculty members as well, even if we get 25 or 30 people, that's 25 or 30 more than we didn't have coming previously. And if we can help a few, then you know that's I think we're achieving the goal. Certainly, I want to get even more. So we have some information on that there. Let me see, the grade 8 open house, certainly this is the first year that we had that in November, and making sure reaching out to our 8th grade families in both Berkeley and Somerset and establishing that rolling out the welcome mat to Somerset Berkley, making sure that there was that connection early on in the eighth grade year, where students get to experience a little bit about what Somerset Berkley has to offer. And again, like I said earlier tonight, having the basketball game here too, just any way that we can make those connections to our eighth graders and make sure that they know that this is going to be their future home for high school. If we're going to take those opportunities whenever we can get them. So those were some of the things that that we've been working on, and I summarized that in a reflection. The student learning goal is on 21st century skills development and really the focus on STEM and career and tech ed programs. So some of the information I have there, I talk about the career voc and tech ed programming that took place this past year. We successfully created a television production advisory board. We were unsuccessful in having the program approved by the state, but we have started the program. It's only in its second year. We've built up a lot of fan support in the program. We have students now actively engaged in our school committee meetings and producing all kinds of wonderful material for not just the students to see, but parents and community members. But we have that, we will continue to investigate how we can get Chapter 74 program and television production. More recently in December, I put together the first computer programming advisory committee. We met briefly in mid-December, and we're going to talk about, we started talking about a plan for computer science at Somerset Berkley, and just the goals. What should be the final outcomes of a 3 or 4 year sequence of courses that we can ultimately offer? Let's see here. Obviously, with the 21st century skills, in November we rolled out that the personalized learning environment for utilizing our Chromebooks. We all know all the work that went into that, and it's still 2 months, about 2 months old at this point. And every time I walk around the school, as I did this morning, there are some classes that we're not expecting all classes to be using them all the time. And as Kara talked about her own experiences earlier, today I was in health classes, English classes, and social studies classes. And at various amounts, degrees, they were being utilized either on students taking assessments online, students working in groups, collaborating through their Chromebooks, and other students doing independent work using them. And then there were other classes that weren't utilizing them at all. It was, you know, some other form of teaching and learning that did not require the devices. But certainly that was a big component of making sure that we are giving kids all the opportunities for 21st century learning. With this relative to STEM, we have, and I'll talk more about this at a future meeting, but we continue to look at our science sequence. We did make a big change this current school year. We've talked about it before with the physics first sequence, where we flip chemistry and biology around. So students now go from physics to chemistry to biology. We know the emphasis on biomed and the biosciences are just booming in the state. I mean, it really is a primary industry in Massachusetts, but nationally, globally. And there's so much, the study of biology now is so dependent on chemistry and physics that sequence makes the most sense for our students. So we did make that change this year. Changes that we've already made for next year include making AP Chemistry a sophomore class so that students no longer have to take a full year of chemistry before going into AP Chemistry. They no longer have to take a full year of biology before going into AP Biology. Sophomores who want to take AP Chemistry will be able to take it next year. Juniors who want to take AP Biology will be able to take it as a junior without having to wait until the senior year. We've talked about in detail about the science enrollment in our AP classes. We want to build that up. And right now, the way our structure has been, they're all competing for the same pool of students in the senior year with a few juniors taking AP sciences. But this way we're going to follow a model that the English has followed, that social studies has followed, and math, where they're spread out. And we are very hopeful that we're going to encourage more students to enroll in AP sciences. Let me see here. Okay. In addition to the professional practice and student learning goals, superintendents are required to have at least two district improvement goals. I have three, the first of which is the district strategy implementation. So I just included some information, just the current strategic plan, a one-page summary of it, and you'll see on the more detailed version there are some a table of metrics that they're still being determined exactly. You'll see that there are some TBDs in there, but just ways that we're going to measure the success of the district strategy. And in the summary and reflection, I've outlined a number of the things that have happened for student learning, for teaching, and for family and community engagement. The one that I really have not done much work on, and it's going to take my work with the school committee, is building that sustainable funding model. So that's something that we need to work together in developing those key performance indicators that are listed, and just how are we going to make sure that we are building that sustainable funding model. And obviously that would require Mrs. Albernez's expertise as well. The second district improvement goal is organizational leadership and professional learning communities. It's building a culture of collaboration, trust, and creative thinking, collective inquiry among administrators and staff, working together to meet the students' needs and to advance the vision and mission of the high school. Working with staff in different ways, and in the summary I talk about the contract negotiations that we've had this past year, working with AFSCME custodial and the administrative assistants, as well as the teachers, two were successfully started and completed. Obviously with teachers, we're not there yet. But I also talked about the learning walks, which I've shared that information with you before, and how that process has continued to evolve. Making sure that teachers have a greater say. We heard last year, we central office heard that teachers felt that they didn't have a lot of say in professional development. So we made sure that Ms. Haskell surveyed all of our teachers, and we used that information at a leadership meeting in March, and we determined with principals, so both districts obviously, we worked with principals to determine what the professional development offerings would be this year. And one of the things that came out of it was the EdCamp model, which I talked to you about in November, and how successful that was. The third district improvement goal is data-informed decision making. So with this, we focused with content coordinators and with principals across both districts in June, right when school ended. We spent a day or two together, and then two more days together in August. We purchased a book, Using Data to Improve Learning for All. For all those members of that extended leadership team, and we used that to guide the work that we did in August. We created a data inventory, which we had not done that before. I've attached the copy of the Somerset Berkley version of that for you, and just described a few of the ways that either we've used data this past year or we're currently using it. And honestly, everything we do is nothing is by the seat of our pants. Everything is data-driven, and there's a reason why. There's evidence to back our decisions. I've tried just to give a few of the examples of things that of how I'm either using it now or how we've used it in the past. But for instance, the CIA team, one of the conversations we had this past year was identifying students in grade 9, for instance, who are failing at least one class, and or who have had chronic absenteeism. And we want to go back and trace the historical attendance and achievement data, as well as some suspension data, to see, is there other patterns? Can we predict when those problems begin to surface? so that we can, rather than being so reactive later on in upper middle school and in high school, can we begin to identify those problems early enough so we can be proactive earlier, so it never reaches the point where we have high school students thinking that you know, the challenges and the obstacles that are facing are insurmountable. So we're looking at that. We're looking at our out-of-school suspension data. I want to see how in-school suspensions, Saturday school detention, Saturday schools are affecting our out-of-school numbers. So just a number of different things that we're using. I've talked about using Aspen as a data warehouse before. We have, our data specialist has put all of our achievement data into Aspen, so it's, we can all, any teacher can go in, look up a student's profile, and they can see their MCAS data, their APs, PSATs, SATs. We never had that before. We had to go into multiple sources or have guidance, look for it for us. It's all right there now.
I was going to ask, because this has been years of progressing towards this, how have you seen our educators kind of take that approach? Because now they have it at their fingertips, more readily available than they did before. Are they using it in figuring out how they can structure their lessons or how they can improve their classes, et cetera?
That Aspen data was just put in the last few months. Okay. So we just made it available. In fact, I think Andrea is still, there are still some levels of data that she's still inputting when she can. So we're not there yet. It's there now, but that's the next step. How can we use that and make sure that everyone is aware that that information is there? And then with the four standards, and this ends up getting repetitive, and I will not go over everything that's here, but we now have the instructional leadership standard, which is focuses on instruction, assessment, the evaluation, and data-informed decision-making. A lot of the things I've already described are referenced under that standard. For management and operations, the focus and for that standard is on environment, laws, ethics, and policies, and fiscal systems. In addition to some of the things I've already talked about, obviously, I mentioned the bullying intervention and bullying prevention and the 504 guidelines that the school committee updated this past year. Those are results, Mrs. Martesian. Certainly, with the 504 guidelines, is instrumental in making sure that as soon as the U.S. Department of Education came up with some new guidelines, that within a few months, the school committees already had an updated version related to those the guidelines that they gave. And bullying prevention, we've talked about that. And on the website too, I've listed resources for students, for teachers, so that if there is ever a question, then they can go there, as well as having those multiple forms of expressing or reporting bullying claims, whether it's online, anonymous phone calls, or the traditional paper form. Standard three, family and community engagement. In addition to some of the things that I've said already, we had the hidden in plain sight here in the in this room, in this library, during our parent-teacher conferences this year. I continue to work when I can on the Bristol County Chamber of Commerce Education Committee. We brought the Credit for Life in this past year for our freshmen and our seniors. I've continued to meet with people from Bridgewater State, UMass Dartmouth. I've met recently with representatives from Stonehill and PC, just learning more and trying to build partnerships for the high school with our local universities. And let's see. Last, professional culture. It's a commitment to high standards, mission, and core values. A lot of what I have under the district strategy, district improvement goal is listed there, as well as some of the other information that I've described already. So that's a quick recap, but you have the information. If you have any specific questions, please let me know.
Any questions?
No.
All right. I received that this afternoon and attempted to print some of it off, and I was not successful. So I will try again. If I'm not, then I'll have to ask that I be provided with a hard copy. So we're going to have to, we're going to have to revise our schedule on the response from the committee on the evaluation. So we'll review that and get out a schedule of trying to provide an adequate amount of time to do a comprehensive job in preparing individual evaluations for the superintendent. So next, we have citations for Eagle Scouts, Scott LeBeau Jr., Alexander Pelletier, and Colin Ryder. Somewhat unusual to have three Eagle Scouts from our high school all at the same time. I understand that these three Scouts have earned this over the course of the last year in their Court of Honor, which they'll be formally recognized, presented with their Eagle Scout Award, is scheduled for Sunday, January 28th. I've been invited to attend to represent the committee, and we have citations for each of the three. They're similar in most respects. There is an introductory paragraph which attempts to recognize accomplishments of the individual students, but I'll read one of the citations. Does the committee have copies? All right. I'll read the citation for Colin M. Ryder. Whereas Colin M. Ryder is a senior at Somerset Berkley Regional High School, where his academic achievements, as well as his leadership in the class of 2018 and his involvement in extracurricular activities such as Big Buddies and Best Buddies, which provides mentoring to other students, reflect his real commitment to the Scout Oath and Law. Whereas he has devoted himself to scouting in the last several years as a member of Troop 21, whereas he has attained the rank of Eagle Scout through hard work, perseverance, and devotion to scouting. Whereas his Eagle Scout service project embodies his qualities of leadership and commitment to his community by leading a team of fellow scouts in refurbishing the bleachers at the Ashton Field Complex. Whereas the rank of Eagle Scout is a goal achieved by only 5% of young men involved in scouting. And whereas, as an Eagle Scout, he will always carry its special significance not only as a scout, but also as he enters higher education, a career, and a future community service. Therefore, be it resolved that the members of the Somerset Berkley Regional School Committee, for ourselves, our students, faculty, staff, and administration, recognize the outstanding achievement of Colin M. Ryder in attaining the rank of Eagle Scout, and extend to Colin best wishes for the continued success which this achievement foretells. Scott A. LeBeau is a senior at Somerset Berkley High School, Regional High School. Through his countless community service hours and projects, while also helping out with the Somerset Lions Club, Scott reflects his commitment to living the ideals of the Scout Oath and Law. A paragraph which reads, his service project embodies his qualities of leadership and commitment to his community and its proud history by leading a team in refurbishing the interior of Somerset's historic fire barn on Main Street. The other provisions of the citation are the same as for Colin. Sorry about that. I'll turn that on to check my schedule. And finally, for Alexander J. Pelletier, is a junior at Somerset Berkley Regional High School, where his achievements as a student and athlete reflect his commitment to living out the ideals of the Scout Oath and Law. And similarly, his service project embodies his qualities of leadership and commitment to his community and its proud history by organizing and leading a team and refurbishing a reading room at Somerset Historical Society's James E. Bradbury Museum. So we congratulate all three of these young men who are students at Somerset Berkley Regional High School And I entertain a motion to approve all three citations.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Gagliardi and seconded by Mr. Giliducci. Any further discussion?
So you'll present these on the January 25th to them?
Yes.
Okay, great. That's it.
And so all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. We've touched on the February-March meeting schedule. The Bristol County Chamber of Commerce membership is an issue that Mr. Machado asked to be on the agenda, so we'll defer that until he's here. We also have a citation for Colleen Fieldhauer, who is retiring as an administrative assistant. So I will read that. At a meeting of the Somerset Berkley Regional School Committee on January, we'll have to change that date. January 20th. A citation was prepared, signed by members of the committee, and voted inscribed in the permanent records. Whereas Colleen H. Fieldhauer served as an administrative assistant for the Somerset Public Schools and Somerset Berkley Regional School District for the past 16 years, and whereas she faithfully and conscientiously performed her duties on behalf of the students and staff at Somerset High School and Somerset Berkley Regional High School, an individual of integrity and high standards who always put the needs of students and staff first, and whereas she fulfilled her duties with the utmost attention to detail and a steadfast commitment to excellence, earning the respect of colleagues, students, and staff, be it hereby resolved that the members of the Somerset Berkley Regional School Committee commend Colleen H. Fieldhauer in the official minutes, recording this expression of appreciation and gratitude to an honored professional of the Somerset Berkley Regional High School District, and extending best wishes for good health and happiness in her retirement years. I will entertain a motion to approve the citation.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Terror and seconded by Mrs. Gagliardi. Is there any discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. So next we have Students of the Month for December and November. So, Students of the Month for November, Abigail Cataret, Business and Personal Finance. Anthony Carbone in Science. Kevin Correa in Music. Samantha Francoeur in Math, Pre-Calculus. Bryce Garrettson, Fine Arts, Ceramics. Esther Gaspar, History. Jared Mello, Health Education, Wellness. Christopher Michalasic, Spanish. Owen Santos, Engineering Technology. And Brandy Souza, English. And for Students of the Month in December, Samuel Aruda, Accounting. Megan Baldwin, Drawing and 2D Design. Catherine Corcoran, Mathematics. Julia Donatella, Forensics Biotechnology. Caitlin Jankowski, Social Studies. Alana Monahan, Health Education, Life and Relationships. Elizabeth Orlando, English Language Arts. Sarah Quintel, Technology and Engineering. And that completes the December Students of the Month. Congratulations to our students for both November and December.
There was also bottom right.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
And
finally, Autumn Ray Ray in music. So again, congratulations to all those students.
Oh, there's one more.
Tiago Silva
in world languages.
Okay, Tiago Silva in world languages. Okay, thank you. All right, so next item on the agenda is Somerset and Berkley updates. Mrs. Terry, do you have anything?
I'm looking for the notes now, so give me a minute.
All right, well, Mr. Giliducci?
Yeah. In November, Mrs. McNamara hosted the annual poetry night for students who are now in fifth grade and their families. The 36 students who were published in the Young American Poetry Digest were recognized at this event where they share their writing and engage in a book signing. And the happy news is the quarterly review of attendance at the end of term one showed that 110 students have earned perfect attendance thus far. These students have had no instances or absence, tardiness, or dismissals since the beginning of the school year. So they're concentrating hard on getting perfect attendance and having less students taking excessive days off. With the support of the PTO, we have entered phase one of our laptop cart project. 30 laptop computers have been ordered to replace the laptops currently on our cart. The laptops that were replaced will become classroom computers for grades 3 and 4 to alleviate the need for computers to be pulled from the cart for reading group use. This will enable the cart to be used for whole group instruction as what's originally intended. The computers have been ordered for this phase of the project. The PTO is investing approximately $18,000 in this purchase. We got a great PTO in that K-4. Okay. Our food drive, the Benefit Oak and Shelf Pantry, was a great success. A full truckload of food was donated during the month of November. And our fourth grade students under the direction of Mrs. Reynolds participated in the Lights On celebration in Berkeley. The students performed selections that featured the handbells. They were spectacular. And Mrs. Reynolds always does an outstanding job at this. And that was a couple of highlights of November. And then we have December. Our early childhood program has had many special winter activities prior to the break. Preschool classes welcomed parents to a winter performance in their classrooms. Students sang, demonstrated their skill at preschool activities, and delighted all in attendance. Kindergartners took an imaginary ride on the Polar Express in their classrooms and enjoyed the story and treats of their journey. Fourth grade students entertained their families with a morning winter concert on December 22nd and the entire Berkeley Community School family that afternoon. Mrs. Reynolds led the group. She's an outstanding music teacher. She's really good. Okay, a school-wide pajama day was held on Friday, December 22nd. Many students and staff were supporting their spirit wear that was sold by the PTO. The MCAS tutorial program invitations have been distributed to all qualified students. English, language arts, and math groups will begin during the week of January 22nd, so they can look forward to doing well with the program. And the winter administration of Dibbles and grade assessments is underway and will take approximately a week and a half to complete. The PTO will meet on January 10th. They are planning some exciting events for our students, including a luau-themed dance for the girls and their leading men, which will take place on February 9th.
All right, thank you.
Dean always does the middle school. He's not here, so.
Well, he'll have to catch us up then.
He'll have to catch up.
Mrs. Terra?
Well, it's not as fun as pajama parties and luau's, that I can tell you. But I will say that we got a $15,000 grant from the Greater Forever Development Corporation for the purchase of Chromebooks at an elementary level for technology education. We had a very short meeting. It was mostly what you heard tonight with the superintendent's live binder with his evaluation progress and accomplishments. So we're working on that eval. We had a budget meeting thereafter. It was, again, a short meeting because we had a budget meeting. That was our highlight. We need more bananas in the tea at this point. That's all I can say. Thank you.
All right, so the next item we have in the agenda is to approve minutes of prior meetings. The first is the open session meeting of December 7th, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to approve the minutes of our open session meeting of December 7th, 2017. Any discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Next. Is the executive session minutes of December 7th, 2017.
So moved.
Second. Is there any discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Next is the joint open session minutes of January 9th, 2018. I'll entertain a motion to approve those minutes.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Terra, seconded by Mrs. Gagliardi. Any discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Next, the joint executive session of January 9th, 2018.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Terra and seconded by Mrs. Gagliardi. Any discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? No. Motion passes unanimously. And finally, the open session minutes of January 9th, 2018. I'll obtain a motion to approve those minutes.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Terra, seconded by Mrs. Gagliardi. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. There are no topics not reasonably anticipated by the chair 48 hours in advance of the meeting. Are there any action items for future meetings? You have the one policy that we'll resubmit to the policy subcommittee. If there's nothing further, is there any public input? Don't appear to be any members of the public here tonight. So
they left like 2 hours ago.
We will have a brief executive session to update on collective bargaining. So I will entertain a motion pursuant to Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 30A, Section 21A3, to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining with the Somerset Teachers Association Units A and B, because an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the bargaining position of the committee, and the chair so declares. The committee will not return to open session at the conclusion of the executive session. I have a motion to that effect.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Gagliardi and seconded by Mrs. Terra. Any discussion? Roll call, Mr. Giliducci.
Aye.
Mrs. Gagliardi.
Aye.
Mrs. Terra.
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Thank you, everyone, for coming.
Thank you.